The body of a Perth mother has been found trapped in a charity bin in Baldivis. Police believe the 33-year-old was trying to get clothes from inside the container when she became stuck.
A sad and confronting scene on a cold, wet Tuesday morning. A woman found dead, trapped inside a Good Sammy charity bin outside the Stockland Shopping Centre in Baldivis.
Approximately 5 o'clock in the morning, a passerby contacted police saying that they'd found a person trapped in a bin.
It's understood the 33-year-old was stuck for hours before being found, her car parked nearby. Initial investigation suggests she was reaching into the container when she became trapped.
Through our investigation so far, it appears to be a non-suspicious death where a person has tragically died through very unfortunate and tragic circumstances.
2 months ago, another woman died while reaching into a charity bin on the Gold Coast. The 43-year-old also found by a member of the public when they went to donate items.
The moment the woman got into trouble was recorded by security cameras here at the shopping centre. Police don't believe there is any foul play and a report will be made for the coroner.
In a statement, a Good Sammy spokesperson said, "We are shocked and saddened to hear the news this morning. Our immediate thoughts are for the friends and family of the woman. This is a tragic situation and we are working with police."
Well, for any person walking along a community street like this and they find a body in a position like this, it would be very, very confronting, and obviously our hearts go out to not only her, the victim's family, but anybody who is involved in this as well.
Anne-Marie Leonard for 10 News First.
Three teenage boys have been charged over a shocking attack on an 83-year-old grandfather. Jeff Cam is still recovering in the state trauma unit at Royal Perth Hospital after police say the three boys aged 14 and 15 bashed him with rocks and a metal pole. It's alleged they tried to steal his scooter as Mr. Cam parked it in his Greenfields home on Saturday. He suffered a large cut to his head. His ear required plastic surgery. The boys will now face children's court. There could be another tense standoff brewing off WA's coast after a seriously ill COVID-infected crew member was airlifted to Perth. The Maritime Union is demanding the entire crew be tested, but the police commissioner has intervened to stop the vessel docking in Fremantle.
A potential COVID crisis looming off the WA coast. Singaporean-owned MV Emerald Ender anchored off Scarborough after an infected crewman was medevaced off the bulk carrier at Geraldton and flown by Royal Flying Doctor to Perth. There are still 20-plus crew on board. Their condition is unknown.
The crew member who's gone to hospital is extremely sick. And it's important that we establish exactly what is the status of the crew that remain on the vessel.
The Premier wants the ship gone from WA waters. The Police Commissioner last night signed an order preventing it from docking, even though it's not due at Kwinana for its load of grain until next month.
Can't be turning ships away when we identify that there are six seafarers on those vessels. We have international obligations, maritime obligations.
The seafarer, aged in his 50s, remains in a stable condition in the intensive care unit here at Sir Charlie's, with calls for the remainder of the crew to be tested as well. It comes as the COVID threat onshore has eased, with Perth and Peel regions enjoying lighter than expected restrictions this morning. Masks are no longer required outdoors, although many people chose to take a cautious approach today. While hotels and restaurants are back in business under the 2 square metre rule and 150 person capacity.
Friday will probably take a bit of a hit, just 150, but it's definitely better than it was before.
Patrons can stand to have a drink at the bar and staff are back earning wages.
Our casuals, we just had to let go for that week. We gave them wine and we gave them some food. We gave them toilet paper just in case.
But larger hospitality businesses are still taking a hit with no sign of any government help.
We don't need to be waiting to see what the Commonwealth does. We're sitting on a $5 billion surplus here in Western Australia and these businesses deserve our support.
Cinemas have reopened but at 50% capacity. Welcome news for the Revelation Film Festival. Its opening night cancelled on Thursday, now going ahead with a limited run.
Incredibly disappointing, but you move on and as things transpire, we're doing good now.
With tickets on sale until Sunday.
Films for everyone, every idea and every sensibility.
Natalie Forrest for 10 News First.
A Tasmanian man accused of skipping hotel quarantine and sparking a statewide manhunt is tonight behind bars. 32-year-old Kyle Stevens arrived in WA after transiting through Sydney on July 1. He was refused entry and ordered to hotel quarantine until the next flight home. But police say he escaped. and after 4 days on the run, was arrested yesterday afternoon on the Northwest Coastal Highway, 1,200 kilometres north of Perth. He and a 28-year-old man accused of helping him escape appeared in Karratha Magistrates Court today. The head of the National Vaccine Task Force is considering military-style planning to overhaul Australia's sluggish rollout. It could involve getting the jab at work and using paramedics and medical students to deliver the doses.
Preparing for action.
Welcome to the war game.
With military-style planning for the ramp-up of the vaccine rollout between the National Task Force and the states and territories.
If you have a think about the sorts of things that can go wrong early, that just helps build resilience into the program.
Australia is currently getting 300,000 doses of Pfizer per week, lifting to 2 million by October. That's when under-40s are most likely to gain access.
But we can't put a hard time on that just yet.
Drive-through jabs and mobile vaccination hubs are all options being considered for when we have more doses, but getting them into arms could need the help of nurses, paramedics and medical students.
We have to make sure that any solution that involves nurses and paramedics doesn't create workforce shortages in other sectors.
Tomorrow, Lieutenant General Frewen and the Treasurer will meet with business leaders to discuss ways the private sector can pitch in, especially big businesses like banks and mining companies, potentially offering vaccinations at work like flu shots often are. Though not all priority workers in the aged care sector have had theirs yet.
We're at the beginning of stage one. It simply isn't good enough.
Chloe Boris for 10 News First.
Melbourne's Grand Prix has become the latest victim of Australia's tough quarantine rules. Perth's Daniel Ricciardo says the news hurts after authorities in the F1 failed to reach an agreement.
For the second year in a row, there'll be no Formula One Grand Prix in Melbourne.
We're simply not in a position to give F1 management or MotoGP the sorts of guarantees and assurances and comfort that they need this week.
Caps on international arrivals and the slow vaccine rollout to blame. Drivers, staff and officials unwilling to do 2 weeks quarantine.
It hurts. I know we're all looking forward to it, and particularly myself, to race in Melbourne again. But look, we've got to keep our chin up, look forward. Hopefully in 2022 it can happen.
There's more hope for the Australian Open, with more Aussies expected to be vaccinated by January.
I am confident of that, yes.
The difference between November and January, we would expect that difference to be quite profound.
It comes as Sydney's aged care outbreak is worsening. Lona Patrick, the wife of resident Alan, who tested positive on Saturday, has also contracted the virus.
I feel sick, you know, sick to my stomach. The reality of this is we can now lose both our parents.
A third worker, also positive, with the centres remaining unvaccinated residents today given their jabs. Another cluster is growing too. Of the 10 people at an apartment party, 7 have now tested positive, as well as 5 of their household contacts.
When the time is right, New South Wales Police will make their own inquiries.
The 12 NRL players have paid a hefty price for their own post-match party, fined $305,000 by the league for putting the entire season at risk, while party host and star player Paul Vaughan has been sacked by the club.
When something happens at your club that puts the whole competition in jeopardy, it's a pretty heavy weight to bear, so incredibly frustrating.
There was a total of 18 new cases across New South Wales today, and as the virus continues to circulate, it's an anxious wait for Sydneysiders. A decision on lockdown lifting expected tomorrow.
We only intend for this lockdown to be the only lockdown we go through, and that will factor into our decision making as to whether it finishes on Friday or whether we continue for a period longer.
Queensland recorded one new case today, a student nurse linked to an existing cluster. But it's the far north now on alert after a woman's dramatic escape from a Cairns quarantine hotel.
This person has scaled two balconies, gone downside an outside staircase, and then has damaged a door to escape.
She roamed the community for a day before being arrested and fined $2,000.
On her first test in quarantine, she was negative, and we're awaiting the outcome of a secondary test.
Jessica Brown for 10 News First.
Off-duty medics have helped save the life of a shark attack victim. The surfer was in waters off the New South Wales coast when a 3-metre great white lunged from the waves.
Holidaying surgeons suddenly back on duty, huddling around a young surfer to save his life. This hole in Joe Hoffman's board showing the sheer size of the attacking shark.
I just saw a huge chunk out of his arm and a massive chunk out of his board.
The passionate surfer from Queensland's Sunshine Coast initially mistook the shark for a pounding wave.
He seemed lucid. He was talking at the time, so... He was very lucky there were some good people on the scene.
Help was at hand even before paramedics arrived, with other surfers creating a makeshift tourniquet.
They had a leg rope wrapped around his arm quite tightly and the wetsuit was fairly shredded.
Some of his helpers are trauma specialists at the same hospital he was taken to. Joe arrived in a serious condition. Today he underwent surgery to repair his right arm, and at this stage, it appears it won't require amputation. Authorities have used photos of his bite marks to establish that a 3-metre great white was responsible. The beach has now been closed as they try to track and tag the creature. But the lure of decent swells and low tide proved too tempting for surfers.
It's bad news, but at the end of the day, there's sharks out there. You know the consequences if you paddle out.
It's not the wisest of decisions, no, definitely not. But I can't stop people going into the water.
Joe's family has flown down to Newcastle to be by his side. Michael Hammond for 10 News First.
Millions of bank customers have been hit by an online outage that left many unable to pay for bills or shopping. CommBank confirmed a tech glitch started to affect its app just before 10 this morning. Customers slammed the financial giant on social media, saying it was the third outage in as many weeks. Services were gradually brought back around 2 hours later with no explanation about what caused the issue.